reason being, it is far, far more complicated than sub-4 racing. And the reason for the complication with wall racing is because there are so many different options that are available to you, and so many different places where you can put wall racing elements. That, you know, when we were doing it in the old days, when this course used to run a whole year, it used to take us 2 weeks just to do bracing, and then we would do what we used to call POEs and in-class activities. It really was quite a task, right? So that's why we're going to drop bracing the walls, mainly because, you know, we just won't be able to cover it properly for you guys in order for you to then complete the assignment. But in saying that, I can quickly tell you how you go about calculating, you know, producing a wall bracing plan, which is, if you think about it, that will either be a ground floor or first floor. So the first thing that you do is you start with the building criteria, right, like we had before, in terms of location, planning, little H, big H, all that kind of stuff. You go to the modeling exercise, the bracing sheets that we get from 3604, exactly the same kind of thing that we did before. You fill in the sheets just like we did before, right? All of that is the same, despite the fact that you're dealing with wall. You know, all of that, you're working at the bracing requirement is still the same. This is where it gets complicated. This is when it starts to get complicated for walls. For a start, instead of being 5 meters, it becomes a 6 meter spacing, right? So we still follow the same rule as in external walls, is the M, O, A, and D. But do you see what's happened now? Remember how we had A, B, C, D, E for sub-floor bracing? Now we've only got four of them, right? And one of the main reasons is the fact that you're allowed to have them at 6 meter spaces. Okay? Not only that, if we use collar ties, remember how we talked about collar ties? If we provide a collar ties, it can allow us to make these gaps even bigger. You know, the spacing between our bracing lines. Okay, so that's definitely a difference. The other difference is, so you see how bracing line A is right on that wall line, and same with E, same with B. Okay? You see how bracing line C is actually in between this wall and that wall. Okay? So what wall bracing does is, unlike sub-floor bracing, where it has to be exactly on the on the location, on where your piles are. What you can do with walls is that you can, so long as they're within 1 meter of your bracing line, so this bracing line is C, that runs through here, it's in between this bit of wall and that bit of wall. And so long as those walls are not more than 1 meter away from this bracing line, then they can be counted as contributing to bracing line C. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay, so that's the other difference. Eh? Your bracing lines don't necessarily have to be right on top of walls, right? What you do is you place your bracing lines strategically so that you can take, and in this case, they're quite good to grab that wall and that wall because they're close enough that they will contribute to it. The other thing with bracing with walls is that you can either have your bracing elements on one side or on both sides, okay? You can have a whole lot of different types of bracing elements. A bracing element might only be it could be 800 millimeters, it could be 1.2, it could be the whole wall. So believe me, there is just a whole lot of other, other factors that you need to take into consideration, you know? Not only the type of bracing element that you put in, but the length, okay, whether it's on both sides or one side, and even, uh, I, comes into it. But honestly, it takes quite a bit of experience to produce an accurate bracing plan, a wall bracing plan. For me, when I have to do this is where I throw into the structural engineer and just let them crunch the numbers for me, because it's just full of, I wouldn't say complications, but full of possibilities that I would rather an experienced and somebody who, a capable person producer for me, rather than me, having a go at it and then finding that I'm quite wrong. Okay, so if that's how I feel about it, I'd hate to throw it at you and then ask you to produce a wall bracing plan, because I think you will be totally lost. You've got to be able to do the calculations, right? That's not a problem. Working out what the bracing requirements are, you may even be able to suss out where your bracing lines go, but actually coming up with the final product, that is where your bracing elements go, that is a real challenge, which it does need quite a bit of experience. So that's the reason why we're not going to do it. It's simply, we simply don't have the time to do it. You okay with that? Or do you want us to do it? Well, I'll tell you what, let's do the roof. Because I think that's all we've got, time for today. Maybe if you really want to challenge yourself, just have a look at the exercise and see if you can follow it through. It might be quite a good little exercise for you guys. But anyway, let's look at roof bracing. Two like that equals one bracing element, and that will make sense to you in a minute when I explain to you why that's important. In this case, we're actually you've been given what the overhangs are, and that's important too, because we need to work out the roof area. Okay, we also need to know the roof type. We've been given that it's a light roof. Okay, so it's as simple as this. So there's a roof bracing plan calculation sheet. So you put in the type of roof that we've got. You put in the type of brace that we're going to use. And the rule is that if it's a light roof, you need 1 per 50 square meters of roof area. Okay, per plane. So if the roof looks like that, that's one plane. Are you with me? Okay? Obviously, if the roof is like that, if it's just a mono pitch, then the whole thing is just a single plane. But the roof, if the roof is like that, that's two planes. Okay? So then it becomes a very simple matter of calculations, right? So our roof area is 105, which is slightly more than 100. That means you need three of these. Okay? In this case, we're going to provide four. The reason being, we're just trying to even out the placement and the spread of our bracing elements. So when we go to the next slide, which is our plan. Okay? So there's one, two, three, four. Sorry, that's right, yeah. We need three, but we're providing four, just so that we can even it out, right? And again, what we're doing here is we are trying to put it into the corners to try and strengthen, brace the corners of our roof. Okay, so roof is very simple, right? How many roof plates have you got, and what's the area per roof plate? Okay, and then so long as you stick to using these braces here, these metal straps, and a pair of those gives you one bracing element. Okay, the rule is that you need one per 50 square meters. So in our case, it was just over 100, which means that we needed three of them. But what we've done is we've put in four. One, two, three, four. Okay? So that's the roof. I expect everybody to get the roof 100% correct. There'll be no easy marking for the roof because it's too simple. It's either the right answer or the wrong answer. Again, remember, what you show on your plan needs to match what's on your calculation sheets, okay? So don't go putting three on your calculation sheets and then show only two here. You can show more for the purposes of evening it out, but you can't show less. Okay, so that's the roof. Everybody happy? Okay, team, that's it for today. Any questions? Finish the day off with two summer tournaments.